Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Klondikers, Dawson City's Stanley Cup Challenge, and How a Nation Fell in Love with Hockey, by Tim Falconer, narrated by Matthew Josdal. Prologue. The Canadian Pacific Railway's Continental train was nearly 3 hours late when it pulled up to the station in Winnipeg. Given what the hockey players had been through since leaving the Klondike, this barely counted as a complication. After all, inconvenient forces had started conspiring against them even before they headed out of Dawson City. First, one of the team's stars decided to stay behind with his injured wife. Then the captain and most accomplished player realized he had to stay a little longer for work. He'd try to catch up with the others as soon as he could. The team's luck did not improve once the journey began. Setting out to capture the Stanley Cup and the fame that went with it, the players figured it would be a straightforward 18-day trip. Straightforward by Yukon standards, anyway. Three left on foot on December 18, 1904. Four others followed on bikes the next day, though they all eventually abandoned their wheels. After 330 miles, the team arrived in Whitehorse 2 days after Christmas, only to watch a blizzard shut down the narrow-gauge trains on the White Pass and Yukon Route Railway. When they finally reached Skagway, Alaska, they'd missed their steamer to Vancouver by 2 hours and had to wait days to board a Seattle-bound ship for a voyage that left the players severely seasick. They believed the hardship was worth it. Since 1893, the reward for being Canada's best amateur team was the Dominion Hockey Challenge Cup, a silver bowl donated by Lord Stanley of Preston, the Governor General at the time. Known from the beginning as the Stanley Cup, it quickly became the most prestigious trophy in the land. While the trustees wouldn't allow just any team to contend for the honor, they did approve a challenge from Dawson City's All-Stars. To win the cup, the Yukoners would have to defeat the formidable Ottawa Hockey Club, a team known in lore as the Silver Seven, and the sport's original superstar, One-Eyed Frank McGee. Few hockey people considered the Klondikers a serious threat. The team was from a small subarctic town, and no squad from west of Brandon had yet challenged for the cup, let alone won it. When accepting the challenge, Ottawa insisted the Dawson team not play any exhibition matches en route. Rather than an attempt to ensure their opponents would arrive unprepared, this was to avoid any losses to weaker teams that might discourage ticket sales for the Cup Series. The original plan, as set out by Joe Boyle, the brash businessman managing the tour, was for a layover in Winnipeg to do some training. But the team was so far behind schedule, that was no longer an option. With just a 2-hour stop before continuing on to Ottawa, the players didn't have enough time to do much more than stretch their legs and assure reporters their challenge was no joke. Despite the team's lack of star power, the cross-country trek charmed Canadians. Though the codified version of the sport was only 3 decades old, passion for hockey had swept the nation since Lord Stanley had donated the cup and was only intensifying. But there was more to the enthusiasm for the underdogs from the Yukon than a love of the game. The Klondike Gold Rush was over, but people continued to romanticize the North. And the long journey from that faraway land to the nation's capital fit into that mystique. All along the route, fans had cheered the Yukon team, and it was no different in the home of the champions, where the Citizen reported, "The matches are creating the greatest interest of any Stanley Cup contests yet played in Ottawa." at 4:45 on January 11th, 1905, 3.5 weeks after leaving Dawson City, the hockey players stepped off the train and onto the platform at Ottawa's Central Station, where a large and appreciative crowd gave them a right hearty reception. Bob Shillington, the manager of the cup-holding team and other club executives, led the players away to the Russell House. A throng overflowed the hotel's rotunda in hopes of catching a glimpse of the exotic visitors. But the cordial welcome didn't mean the hosts were about to grant Dawson's request for a one-week postponement before starting the best-of-three series. Meanwhile, the challengers denied a newspaper report that they default the series opener and focus on the second and third matches rather than play unprepared. The first game would go ahead as scheduled, with Earl Grey, the new Governor General, facing the puck at 8:30 p.m. on Friday the 13th. After nearly a month on the road, the exhausted and far from game-shape Klondikers would take on the reigning Stanley Cup champions before a sellout crowd of 2,500 fans at Day's Rink in just over 48 hours. Part 1. 1. It looks like any other trophy, I suppose. Still just 20 years old, the boyishly handsome and clean-cut Weldon Champness Young was already a veteran star with the Ottawa Hockey Club when he went to the Russell House for a formal banquet. The March 1892 evening, hosted by the Ottawa Amateur Athletic Club, was to celebrate his team's season. So it was fitting that when Weldy, as everyone called him, and the other guests sat down at the elegant play settings, they found menu cards that told two tales. One side, as usual, set out the fine fare the hotel would serve that Friday night. The other showed the names of the OHC players and an account of another impressive season. In 10 matches that winter, the squad had won 9 times, scoring 53 goals and allowing only 19. This was the record, according to the Evening Journal, of a genuine amateur team playing for pure love of sport and treating all comers as they wished to be treated themselves. More than 75 sportsmen had gathered in the dining room to honor the players. But by the end of the night, they'd have something else to cheer about. Located a short walk from Parliament Hill, on the southeast corner of Sparks and Elgin Streets, the 5-story Russell House was the city's finest hotel. Popular with Ottawa's high society, who enjoyed the luxurious public rooms and excellent food, the establishment was the obvious choice for a banquet that attracted many distinguished local gentlemen, as well as guests from Montreal and Toronto, and featured music from the Governor General's Foot Guards Band. Women joined the festivities around 9:30 p.m., taking seats in a wing of the dining room, and the hotel staff served coffee and ices. At 10 o'clock, OAAC President J.W. McRae began the evening's formal proceedings. A lengthy round of toasts was a regular part of such gatherings, and by tradition, the host always led off with one to the Queen. After McRae had done so, Philip Danskin Ross, the Evening Journal publisher and OAAC past president, drew cheers for his toast to the health of the Governor General, including complimentary remarks about the Englishman's staunch support of sports, especially hockey. In 1888, an aging Queen Victoria had tapped Frederick Arthur Stanley, the 47-year-old son of a former Tory prime minister, to be her Canadian representative. After serving 2 decades in Parliament, where he held several portfolios, including Secretary of State for the Colonies, Baron Stanley of Preston entered the House of Lords in 1886. Yet his career always seemed overshadowed by the political accomplishments of his father and brother. The viceregal position in Ottawa, not exactly the most glamorous or warmest city in the British Empire, sure wasn't about to change that. In fact, it sounded more like a retirement posting. Initially, he declined the Queen's offer, but Lord Salisbury, his Prime Minister, talked him into becoming the Dominion of Canada's 6th Governor General. When he arrived in Ottawa in June 1888, Stanley was a middle-aged aristocrat, about 5 feet 10 inches tall, with a stout build. He kept a grizzled beard, and above his broad forehead his hair was thinning and starting to gray. The New York Times described him as having a commanding and soldier-like appearance, and being decidedly good-looking. He came from a sporting family. In 1780, his great-grandfather, the 12th Earl of Derby, created the Derby, the second and most prestigious of the 3 horse races that make up the British Triple Crown. Although he showed less interest in art and literature than his father had, Stanley shared his family's passion for horse racing, as well as its love of hunting, fishing, and cricket. He and his wife, Lady Constance, had 10 children, 8 of whom survived to adulthood. 4 of the offspring arrived in Canada with their parents, and others followed. The family quickly embraced winter, snowshoeing, tobogganing, and most of all, the nascent sport of hockey. Unable to attend the banquet, Stanley sent his aide-de-camp, Lord Kilcoursey. During his time in the Grenadier Guards, Frederick Rudolph Lambert had been known as Fatty, because he was short and stocky, and his trousers were too short and a yard too broad in the seat. Having racked up gambling debts, he left England in 1891 to work for Stanley. He quickly took to hockey, playing regularly with members of Ottawa's elite and his boss's sons, and occasionally with his boss himself. Responding to the toast, he noted that while Stanley might not have the agility of OHC captain Herbert Russell or the speed of Weldy Young, he was a decent player and a clever body checker. Then Kilcoursey read a letter from His Excellency. "I have for some time past been thinking that it would be a good thing if there were a Challenge Cup, which should be held from year to year by the championship hockey team in the Dominion. There does not appear to be any such outward or visible sign of the championship at present, and considering the interest that hockey matches now elicit, and the importance of having the games fairly played under rules generally recognized, I am willing to give a cup that shall be held from year to year by the winning club." Thrilled, the dinner guests applauded enthusiastically, and the good mood in the room rose some more. When McRae proposed a toast to the hockey team, friends and supporters stood on their chairs to drink it. Then, each player responded. Russell went first with a much-appreciated humorous speech. Young earned a special round of applause for raising a glass to the good fellowship among the OAAC clubs and their members. The last player to speak, Chauncey Kirby, added emphasis by standing on the table. Eventually, Kilcoursey was on his feet again with a song he'd composed. Called The Hockey Men, it began, "There is a game called hockey. There is no finer game. For though some call it knocky, yet we love it all the same. 'Tis played in this dominion, well played both near and far. There's only one opinion, how 'tis played in Ottawa." Verses about the Ottawa players followed, and were, if possible, even cornier than the first two. The stanza about Young, who played cover point, one of two defense positions, went, "At cover point, important place, there's Young, a bulwark strong. No dodging tricks or flying pace will baffle him for long." The audience hooted and clapped at the mention of each player. Everyone loved the performance. After more songs, toasts, and speeches, the guests sang God Save the Queen and then belted out Auld Lang Syne before heading home or moving on to the next party at midnight. The evening had been a great success. The delight at Stanley's promised gift had come from hockey people, including players, league, and club officials, and other hangers-on. Still, their excitement over a trophy to recognize the nation's championship team revealed a lot about the growing ardor for the sport. And having been among the first people to hear about it, Weldy Young would never shake his desire to win the honor. Although Canada had its own fine silversmiths, Stanley opted for an imported trophy. He asked Captain Charles Colville, his former military secretary, to handle the arrangements in England. Colville, who'd also played hockey with Stanley's sons, visited George Richard Collis and Company on Regent Street, even then a high-end shopping strip in London's West End. He paid 10 guineas for a late Victorian punch bowl with gold gilding inside on a pedestal base. The trophy was slightly more than 7 inches high and 11 across. Engraved on one side was Dominion Hockey Challenge Cup. The other side read, "From Stanley of Preston," above his family crest. After the small crate arrived at Rideau Hall in April 1893, the donor told a British sports writer who'd asked him to describe the cup. "It looks like any other trophy, I suppose." Still, he was pleased enough that he invited John Sweetland to pick it up. A doctor and the sheriff of Carleton County, Sweetland was one of two Ottawa gentlemen Stanley had asked to be trustees of the cup. P.D. Ross, the newspaper publisher, was the other. Although Stanley was popular and remains among the country's best-known governors general, conventional historical thinking has it that he was an unimaginative, even inconsequential, viceroy who served a largely uneventful term. In Lord Stanley, the man behind the cup, Kevin Shea and John Jason Wilson argue against that take. "Stanley's endorsement of hockey," they write, "may have contributed more to cultural identity in Canada than any other figurehead, never mind Governor General, in Canadian history." For sure, he'd picked just the right moment in the development of the sport to donate a trophy. But there was more to it than good timing. The nation that had emerged out of a collection of colonies in 1867 was technically just a self-governing dominion and definitely still part of the empire. In fact, people born in Canada or naturalized immigrants were British subjects. This didn't change until 1947 with the Canadian Citizenship Act. So colonial thinking lived on. Most English Canadians were ardent Anglophiles and monarchists, and if the Queen's own representative approved of this new game enough to donate a trophy, people took it seriously. Hockey must be something Canadians should enjoy. So they did. No one had any idea the sport would help speed the development of a new, more independent, and less British culture in the country. The letter Kilcoursey read didn't include the word amateur, but the line about the importance of having the games fairly played under the rules revealed Stanley's thinking. Sportsmanship was a crucial tenet of amateurism, and the Governor General clearly wanted to support and reward amateurs, which, by its original definition, meant white men with some degree of wealth. Professionalism wasn't a concern in hockey yet. The game was too new for that. But pay-for-play had invaded more established activities such as baseball and boxing, causing concern within the elites. In the 19th century, the country's attitude to sports was, predictably, based on the British one, and reflected Victorian England's view of honor, fair play, and manliness, as well as its preoccupation with social class. But Canada was going through a period of profound social and technological change, which helped spread the game. Hockey proved so popular that before long, people from other classes and ethnic groups would pick up the sport. Stanley's daughter, Lady Isabel, and other women also enjoyed hockey, but his trophy was meant to encourage boys and men at a time when the British believed society was facing a crisis of manliness. While Arthur Wellesley, the first Duke of Wellington, never actually said, "The Battle of Waterloo was won on the playing fields of Eton," he said, "It is here that the Battle of Waterloo was won, while at the posh boys' school." The misquotation revealed a lot about the British attitudes towards sports, war, and empire, even decades later. Hockey players valued sportsmanship, but violence was a controversial part of the sport from the beginning. Over the years, many people have tried to explain the game's brutal side. 6 decades after Stanley left Canada, Hugh McLennan, who wrote about the nation's linguistic and cultural duality in his novel Two Solitudes, eloquently captured part of the appeal of the game in Fury on Ice, a 1954 magazine article. "To spectator and player alike, hockey gives the release that strong liquor gives to a repressed man," he wrote. "It is the counterpoint of the Canadian restraint. It takes us back to the fiery blood of Gallic and Celtic ancestors, who found themselves minorities in a cold new environment, and had to discipline themselves as all minorities must. But this combination of ballet and murder, as an Al Purdy poem puts it, has always been about much, much more than on-ice mayhem for Canadians." French-born American historian and cultural critic Jacques Barzun noted, "Whoever wants to know the heart and mind of America had better learn baseball, the rules and realities of the game, and do it by watching first some high school or small-town teams." He could have switched out America and baseball for Canada and hockey and achieved similar wisdom. Stanley's simple gift, just an unremarkable silver bowl, much like any other trophy by his own admission, may have been more symbolic than anything else. But symbols are often powerful. And before the decade was out, Canadians across the country, as far away as the Yukon, dreamed of winning the Stanley Cup. 7 years after attending the banquet that launched an obsession, Weldy Young moved to the Klondike, leaving behind his team and his hometown, but not his hunger for the cup. The gold rush had already peaked, but there were still opportunities worth pursuing, and he was hardly the only delayed stampeder. During his first couple of years in the subarctic, he offered occasional updates on life in Dawson for people outside, as Yukoners called everywhere south of the territory. In a summer 1900 letter, he covered local politics, a mild smallpox outbreak, and the doings of several former Ottawa residents. He also made an announcement that must have seemed particularly outlandish, given the northern town hadn't even existed 5 years earlier. "And now, by way of warning, let me break the news gently, a challenge from the Dawson Hockey Club for the possession of the Stanley Cup is now being prepared," Young wrote. And, Let me further inform you, outsiders, that if a team is sent, you do not want to hold us too cheaply. 2. I think we could beat those fellows. It was a great day for hockey. Spring comes late in Montreal, and in early March of 1875, winter's end seemed a long way off. The mercury barely made it up to 18 degrees on the third day of the month. James George Aylwin Creighton welcomed the cold. The ice at the Victoria skating rink would be hard, and since it was indoors, he didn't have to worry about the snow that had fallen the past 2 days. Creighton wasn't looking forward to just another late-season match. He'd organized the sport's first indoor game, an event that would come to represent the beginning of modern hockey. Basketball has a widely accepted creation myth. James Naismith, originally from Almont, a mill town in Ontario's Ottawa Valley, became an athletics instructor at McGill University while studying theology at Montreal's Presbyterian College. After moving to the International YMCA Training School in Springfield, Massachusetts, he invented the indoor game in 1891 as a form of winter conditioning for athletes. Hockey, on the other hand, has ancient roots and evolved slowly and then all at once. Humans have played stick and ball games at least since the Egyptians, and hockey grew out of a tradition that includes Ireland's hurling, or hurley, Scotland's shinty, England's field hockey, and bandy, an on-ice game played for centuries in Russia and Northern Europe. Rugby and lacrosse, which was based on the indigenous game of Bagatawai and codified into the modern settler sport by Montrealer William George Beers in the 1860s, were also crucial influences. The argument over hockey's birthplace may never be settled, especially since much of the wrangling hinges on the definition of hockey. So contentious is the debate that the Society for International Hockey Research's official position, enshrined in a 2016 constitutional amendment, is to take no official position on the matter. Too many towns and cities, including Windsor, Nova Scotia, Kingston, Ontario, and Montreal, have made claims. And there's also evidence of early hockey in New England. The oldest reference appears in the papers of calamitous explorer John Franklin, whose men played a version of the game on a lagoon at Delaunay, an indigenous settlement just south of the Arctic Circle on Great Bear Lake. We endeavor to keep ourselves in good humor, health, and spirits by an agreeable variety of useful occupation and amusement, wrote Franklin in an October 1825 letter. Till the snow fell, the game of hockey, played on the ice, was the morning sport. Less contentious than the birthplace are the details of the first indoor contest. March 3, 1875, at the Victoria Skating Rink. Born in 1850, Creighton had grown up in Halifax and enjoyed sports such as rugby football, figure skating, and a hockey variant with roots in hurling played on the city's frozen harbor. He started studying at Dalhousie University when he was 14. After graduating with an honors engineering degree, he worked on the Intercolonial Railway, which would soon connect the Maritime Provinces with Central Canada. In 1872, he moved to Montreal, where his assignments included the Lachine Canal expansion, the Montreal Harbor, and other infrastructure projects. In his spare time, he made friends with fellow athletes and joined the Montreal Football Club, which played under rugby union rules, and the Victoria Skating Rink. Tall and lean, just 145 pounds in his 20s, he was starting to lose the hair on his head, but he kept his walrus mustache. While he was competitive as an athlete, he was a humble, gentle, and unassuming man. But not so unassuming that he couldn't convince his football friends that hockey would be a good way to train during the winter. He introduced them to the sport, and given Montreal winters, the players must have dreamed of moving inside, away from the wind and snow. The Victoria Rink offered a sheltered venue. The plain but imposing two-story red brick building was located on Drummond below St. Catherine Street and stretched all the way to Stanley Street. From the outside, it looked mostly functional, like it might be an armory or something, but inside it offered some elegance. Wooden trusses curved over the rink to a height of 52 feet. All around the ice, a promenade 8 inches high and 10 feet wide offered standing room for spectators and resting skaters. There was also a director's gallery and a bandstand so musicians could play waltzes for the swarms on blades. The rink was open from 8 o'clock in the morning until 10 o'clock at night. During the day, light came in through the 50 large arched windows on three sides of the building. Several hundred gas jets produced a soft light, more of a glow, actually, at night. For well-heeled Montrealers of Scottish and English descent, the club quickly became a popular spot. The skating masquerades and fancy dress carnivals were much anticipated social events. The ice surface was 202 feet long and 80 feet wide, and the decision by the Montreal architectural firm of Lawford and Nelson to support the pitched roof with the arches, a technique used in European train stations at the time, meant no columns. Aside from the square corners, it was ideal for hockey. Since opening on Christmas Eve in 1862, the rink had operated primarily for one purpose. Figure skaters, speed skaters, and pleasure skaters were all welcome. But, in order to keep the place financially viable, the club occasionally allowed other activities, such as snowshoe races and lacrosse on ice. That may have provided an opening for Creighton. As a figure skating judge, he was sufficiently well-connected to be able to cajole or bribe a caretaker or someone else in authority to allow hockey practices when the rink would otherwise be closed. Soon, the players decided to arrange a formal game. An indoor match required some rule tweaks. Outdoor games sometimes featured dozens of players, the limits being how many skaters were available and the size of the pond, slough, or river. For the smaller ice surface, Creighton and his pals, some of them McGill students, settled on 9-a-side. Many of the basic rules were based on field hockey, but the players used an idea from lacrosse and stood 2 6-foot sticks in the ice, 8 feet apart to create goals. They also agreed on an offside rule that prevented passing to teammates who were ahead of the play. The leading skates at the time were made by the Star Manufacturing Company of Dartmouth, Nova Scotia. The blades attached to boots with a spring apparatus and required no screws. For sticks, Creighton arranged for Halifax friends to send 2 dozen of the best, which were handcrafted by Micmac carvers. A rum barrel plug had served as a puck for Franklin's men. Other early players used a variety of objects, including lacrosse balls, blocks of woods, or even hunks of horse dung. While an unwieldy lacrosse ball was adequate on large ice surfaces, it posed a danger to both spectators and the Victoria Rink's windows. An announcement in Montreal's The Gazette promised, "Good fun may be expected, as some of the players are reputed to be exceedingly expert at the game." The paper added, "Some fears have been expressed on the part of intending spectators that accidents were likely to occur through the ball flying about in too lively a manner, to the imminent danger of lookers-on. But we understand that the game will be played with a flat, circular piece of wood, thus preventing all danger of its leaving the surface of the ice." Hockey players quickly discovered they could handle this projectile with much greater control than they ever had with a ball. The Gazette first called it a puck in 1876. One fanciful but charming etymological theory suggests the disc's tendency to dart about unpredictably, appearing and disappearing without warning, was reminiscent of Puck, the mischievous sprite in William Shakespeare's A Midsummer Night's Dream. The next day, the Montreal Star reported on an interesting game of hockey, which suggested faint praise. The Gazette made it sound a bit more entertaining. The match was an interesting and well-contested affair, the efforts of the players exciting much merriment as they wheeled and dodged each other. Both papers said the crowd was large, though that was a relative assessment. This was a new sport, and only about 40 people stood on the platform surrounding the ice surface that night. By about 9:30 p.m., Creighton's team had won, and the spectators then adjourned, well satisfied with the evening's entertainment. The Gazette didn't mention any violence, but the Montreal Daily Witness did. Some kids, perhaps frustrated their usual ice time had been hijacked, started skating even as play continued. An unfortunate disagreement arose, according to the paper. One little boy was struck across the head, and the man who did so was afterwards called to account, a regular fight taking place in which a bench was broken and other damage caused. A few days later, the story perhaps having grown with time and retelling, Kingston's weekly British Whig ran this front page brief. A disgraceful sight took place at Montreal in the Victoria skating rink over a game of hockey. Shins and heads were battered, benches smashed, and the lady spectators fled in confusion. It would hardly be the last time a Canadian newspaper expressed outrage at violence in hockey. Despite that ill will, the rink hosted another match 2 weeks later. This time, Creighton's team of Montreal Football Club members and a skating club team wore uniforms, and already strategy was crucial to success. Captain Creighton, whose individual play deserves special encomium, did all he could to get his men together and make them play into each other's hands, but to no purpose, reported the Gazette. They seemed to have lost that organized system which distinguished their play at the beginning of the afternoon, and the result was a well-deserved victory for their opponents, who certainly did play exceedingly well and with remarkable science. 2 years later, the McGill University Hockey Club became the sport's first organized team. The Montreal Victorias soon followed, and their secretary mailed contacts in other cities for guidance on the rules, but received no replies. Team captains typically agreed on how they'd play beforehand. But in February 1877, the Gazette published hockey rules along with a game summary. That Creighton, who played in the match, wrote for the newspaper at the time may not have been a coincidence. Hockey didn't become a popular pastime right away, but the participation of McGill students in these early matches helped spread the game because the out-of-towners took their passion for it, along with the new rules, back to their hometowns. Meanwhile, other amateur sports thrived, especially snowshoeing and tobogganing, which, like lacrosse, had come from indigenous culture, and curling. In 1881, local cycling, lacrosse, and snowshoe clubs joined together to create the Montreal Amateur Athletic Association, which organized the first Montreal Winter Carnival. It took place over 5 days in January 1883, and as hoped, attracted lots of tourists, including many Americans, to Montreal. They participated in skating parties and sleigh rides and other social events, visited the massive ice palace in Dominion Square, and watched competitions in sports, including a novelty called hockey. McGill, the Victorias, and Quebec City played a round-robin tournament on the St. Lawrence River. The games featured 2 30-minute periods, a 10-minute intermission, and just 7 players a side, because Quebec showed up with only 7 men, and the Montreal teams agreed to drop 2 from their squads. 2 Ottawa visitors, Jack Kerr and Halder Kirby, watched McGill battle Quebec on the river. People had played shinny in the nation's capital, on the canal and the rivers. But this game was different. Not so different that they were intimidated, though. "I think we could beat those fellows," one of them said. And the other responded, "I think so too." When they returned home, they organized a team. And in early March, the Ottawa Hockey Club played its first game at the Royal Skating Rink. The next year, the OHC joined 4 Montreal teams at the Winter Carnival. This time, organizers requested a 7-a-side tournament, and that became the standard. Except for 1 demonstration game at the Victoria Rink, where a large ice grotto slightly interfered with the play. The matches were outdoors on the McGill campus. The 1885 tournament, indoors at the Crystal Rink near Dominion Square, included Ottawa and 5 local teams. The MAAA's just-formed Montreal Hockey Club won its first championship. A smallpox epidemic meant no Winter Carnival in 1886, so the MHC, McGill, the Victorias, and the Crystals created a schedule of games and agreed to a set of updated rules. The goal would be 6 feet high and 6 feet wide. Sticks could be any length, but not more than 3 inches wide at any point, and the puck must be 1 inch thick and 3 inches in diameter and of vulcanized rubber. A team consisted of 7 players with no substitutions allowed. In the event of injury, the usual solution was for the other team to remove a player to even up the sides. This helped shape hockey's play-through-injuries code. Goalkeepers had to stand. No lying, kneeling, or sitting on the ice allowed. In December 1887, the 4 Montreal teams and the Ottawa Hockey Club formed a proper league called the Amateur Hockey Association of Canada. Quebec City joined the next year. Following another cancellation in 1888, the carnival returned for a final year before collapsing under the weight of high costs and infighting among the organizers. In February 1889, several members of the Stanley family and their aides attended the opening day of the carnival as special guests of the organizers. By the time the entourage arrived at the Victoria Rink at 9:05 p.m., the MHC and the Victorias were already 20 minutes into their match. When Stanley entered, a trumpet blared, the game stopped, and the players lined up at center ice. The band performed "God Save the Queen," and the Vic's captain called for 3 cheers in honor of the Governor General, with the spectators joining in. The viceregal party then made its way to the director's gallery to watch what was an especially entertaining match. One of the finest exhibitions of the Canadian National Winter Game took place last night at the Victoria Rink before an immense crowd, reported the Gazette. Such a surging, swaying mass of dense humanity has seldom packed the gallery and promenades of the rink. Although the paper was premature in declaring hockey Canada's national winter game, the sport was a hit in Montreal. At 10 p.m., before the Vics had eked out a 2-1 victory, Stanley left the building. He and his retinue had enjoyed the match and been impressed by the skill of the players. Hockey had made a few more fans in high places. As it turned out, a skating rink was already an annual feature on the 80 acres of rolling estate that surrounds Rideau Hall, or more formally, Government House, where Governors General live. Lord Dufferin had first requested the installation of a rink in 1872. The tradition continues today, and the ice is open to the public on weekends. Shortly after his family returned from the carnival, Arthur Stanley organized a 5-on-5 game. One team consisted of 3 Stanley boys, Arthur, Edward, and Victor, and 2 of their father's aides-de-camp, including Aubrey McMahon, who'd seen the game in Montreal with the Stanleys, and quickly became an avid hockeyist, as players were often called in those days. They took on a team that featured at least 2 members of Parliament. The rink would soon be the site of many enjoyable games. Meanwhile, hockey began to spread across the country. By the mid-1890s, more and more places in Canada had built covered skating rinks. Electric lights were safer and not as hot as gas ones, making the ice better and the growing number of fans more comfortable. In 1899, less than a quarter century after Creighton organized the first indoor game, Arthur Farrell wrote Hockey, Canada's Royal Winter Sport, the first book about the game. Played in every city, town, village, hamlet, it has aroused more public interest, more enthusiasm, than any athletic pastime that the votaries of sport have yet enjoyed. And as each succeeding year glides by, it grows in popular favor, observed Farrell, a member of the Montreal Shamrocks, Stanley Cup holders from 1899 to 1900. Rinks are springing up everywhere, and even their greatest capacity cannot accommodate the enthusiastic crowds of spectators who rush to witness an exciting match. Like the Klondike Gold Fever, the love of hockey spreads. Canadians were making hockey their favorite game. 3. Best game I know of, hockey. In the spring of 1879, a year after graduating from McGill, P.D. Ross was working for the Montreal Harbor Commission's engineering department. But he really wanted to be in newspapers. He'd loved his time as an editor of the McGill College Gazette and had, as he put it, got the bug. Armed with a letter of introduction from a friend, the lanky young man went down to the Montreal Star and presented himself to Hugh Graham. The future Lord Athelstan had co-founded the populist paper a decade earlier and quickly built the largest circulation in the country. But he had little interest in hiring this eager engineer, and had, he said, no openings. Besides, he took on only junior reporters. When Ross said he'd like to be a junior reporter, the publisher asked him how much he made at the Harbor Commission. $25 a week, Ross told him. That is good pay for a young man, Graham pointed out. He looked relieved, figuring he'd found a way to get rid of the annoying kid. We don't do anything like that for a start in the newspaper business. We pay inexperienced new reporters $5 a week. Thank you very much, Mr. Graham, responded Ross. When can I come? Defeated, the publisher said, Oh, when you like, I suppose. Before the new hire left the room, Graham offered some advice. He spoke slowly and with emphasis. What I want to see in the Montreal Star is the sort of news, or item, or story, or article, which if you saw in some newspaper or book, you would be tempted to read aloud to the next person to you. A few days later, Ross reported to the city editor for work. While the publisher had been reluctant to be taking on a new employee, especially this one, that soon changed. After less than a year, the former engineer became city editor. Long before that, Ross had got the bug for sports. He excelled in rowing, lacrosse, gymnastics, fencing, boxing, and speed skating. At McGill, he'd made the rugby football team in his first year and later captained the club. He also played right wing for the university's hockey club, the sport's first team. The squad arranged exhibition games against social organizations such as the Metropolitan Club, whose membership included James Creighton. On his 21st birthday, New Year's Day 1879, Ross began keeping a journal. That winter, he went skating at the Victoria Rink almost daily, and sometimes played hockey on the river, the canal, or an outdoor rink. On January 23rd, he wrote, "P.M. Down to the river to play hockey on the ice. Hard at work all afternoon and came home pretty stiff. Best game I know of, hockey." A week earlier, he'd watched the Benedicts, a team that included Creighton, play the Bachelors at Victoria Rink, and was excited to be asked to serve as one of the umpires. Although he'd already graduated, Ross still occasionally played for the McGill team. "Our men, McGill, were very unfortunate. Our skates and sticks breaking promiscuously," he wrote after a match in March. "Also, our best player losing his head, and thereby the game. Better luck next time." Ross was several years younger than Creighton, but the two must have played with or against each other in Montreal. There just weren't that many players in the city that they could have avoided each other, even if they wanted to. Oddly, these two jocks also took eerily similar early career paths. Both graduated in engineering and briefly worked in the field before becoming journalists and doing stints in the Parliamentary Press Gallery. After finishing law school at McGill in 1880, Creighton worked for a Montreal legal firm, then moved to Ottawa, where in 1882 he became law clerk to the Senate. Ross stayed in the news business, but also ended up in Ottawa. Both men helped popularize hockey there. Despite his crucial contribution to the first modern match, Creighton's connection to the sport eventually faded, while Ross became increasingly influential. With $50 in his pocket, Philip Simpson Ross was determined to leave Scotland for Canada. His father hadn't wanted him to go, but realizing his son had made up his mind, had offered him $250. The young man declined it. He crossed in 1851, and after a year in Upper Canada, found work as an accountant in Montreal. A few years later, he wrote a Presbyterian minister in Glasgow, giving him the names of three women and a request. Propose to each of them on his behalf, and if one says yes, send her to Canada. Within half an hour of landing in Portland, Maine, Christina Chalmers Danskin married Ross. They stayed together until his death 50 years later. Philip Danskin, their first of eight children, was born in 1858. While still practicing as an accountant, Philip Sr. started a company that sold supplies and equipment to ships, and after he'd made something like a fortune, he bet heavily on real estate. In the 1870s, the chandlery business was in trouble, the victim of fraud by a colleague, and the real estate investments had turned sour. Ross was close to bankruptcy, but he worked his way back, paid off all his debts, and, leaving the company to his brothers, he started P.S. Ross & Sons, which grew into one of the largest chartered accounting firms in the country. Three of the five Ross boys ended up working for their father, but not Philip. Many prominent Montreal families might have disapproved of a university-educated eldest son with journalistic aspirations. After all, to most people from an upper-middle-class background, engineering was a respectable profession. Reporting was not. But in an 1880 letter to his son, the family patriarch wrote, "With regard to your change of profession, my dear son, I never had the slightest objection. I never thought much of the engineers. It is a very exceptional thing to see any of them well off." He went on to add, with the help of a loose biblical quotation, "The warmest wish of my heart is to see my sons and daughters succeed in life. And while I do not think great riches is a sine qua non, yet I would like to help them even to that if I could. I have trained all of you, and your mother has been a true helpmeet in this, to fear God, honor the king, and love the brethren." So, with his father's blessing, P.D. Ross devoted himself to journalism. Shortly after receiving that letter, he left the Star for a reporting position at the Toronto Daily Mail, the conservative organ in the Ontario capital. Indeed, it had launched in 1872 as a competitor to George Brown's liberal paper, The Globe. Because Sir John A. Macdonald found the city's other Tory publications insufficiently supportive. The Star wasn't overly partisan, and politics hadn't been his beat, so Ross didn't know much about covering it. He was in for an education when city editor Tom Grog sent him to a political meeting. The speakers were former Liberal Prime Minister Alexander Mackenzie and Conservative MP Alfred Boultby. By the time Ross turned in his story, Grog had left the newsroom, so the piece ran untouched in the next day's paper. The reporter was pleased when he saw it. The editor was not. "That sure was a rotten job you did last night." "What's the matter?" sputtered Ross. "Was it too long?" "It wasn't too long, maybe, for the right kind of stuff. But a darn sight too long for the sort of slush it is," snarled Grog. "You gave as much space in your report to that man Mackenzie as you did to Mr. Boultby. What the devil do you think we publish a conservative paper for?" Ross kept his job, and had things figured out by the time he met Macdonald at a political meeting. Sir John A., who was serving his second stint as PM, overindulged in red wine at the banquet. So when it was time for him to speak, he was not in good form and kept his address short. Afterwards, Ross received a message that Macdonald wanted to see the Mail reporter at his hotel. When Ross arrived, the Prime Minister was sitting on the bed and had a towel around his head. He seemed completely sober. "Perhaps you haven't got a good report of my speech tonight," he said. "No? Well, I'd better help you. Sit down and take some notes." He then delivered what Ross considered an admirable little speech that lasted at least 15 minutes before asking, "How will that do?" "Fine," said the reporter. "Thank you very much, sir." "All right. Send it off." As Ross was leaving the hotel room, Macdonald added, "Wait a moment, young man. I want to give you a piece of advice." His tone turned stern. "Never again, sir, attempt to report a public speaker when you are under the influence of intoxicating liquor." It wasn't all politics at the Mail. Ross moved from reporter to city editor to what must have seemed the perfect position for him, sporting editor. Celebrity athletes, including prize fighter John L. Sullivan, often dropped by his office. Ned Hanlon, the local boy who'd become the world rowing champion, was a frequent visitor. Sometimes, at the end of the day, half a dozen staffers in no rush to go home would congregate in Ross's shared office on the top floor of the Mail building. They'd push the desks aside, and with Ross serving as referee, two men would don boxing gloves and have at it. Despite working for a Toronto paper, he covered the first Montreal Winter Carnival in 1883 and set the opening day scene. The deep blue of the winter sky was not marred by the smallest cloud, and the atmosphere was so keen and dry that the sleighs and cutters, as they whirled through the streets, raised light clouds of snow, as fine and as penetrating as dust. Mount Royal stood out clear and cold against the western sky, fairly glittering in the sunshine over the white, jagged, and barren expanse of the ice-clad St. Lawrence. About the hockey tournament, he informed Torontonians, most of whom knew nothing of the sport, the game is one of the finest and fastest in the world. Away from the office, Ross continued to build his reputation as a sportsman. A member of the Toronto Rowing Club, and then the Argonaut Rowing Club, he spent a lot of time in Toronto Bay. 6 feet tall and wiry, he had long arms and great stamina, an ideal combination for an oarsman. Both as stroke on four-man crews and as a single sculler, he won 32 races, including the Canadian Fours Championship in 1883. He also joined the Toronto Lacrosse Club, was president of the Toronto Press Lacrosse Club, was a member of a fencing club, and served on the executive of the Canadian Rugby Football Union. But while he did skate on occasion, hockey had yet to make it to the Ontario City. Wanting an evening sibling for their paper, the owners of the Mail started the Evening News in 1881. It also leaned conservative, and after a new editor took over in 1883, it became a muckraking paper that was shamelessly lowbrow and working class. Ross did a stint as telegraph editor and second-in-command at the News. Meanwhile, he continued to write for Montreal Star as a special correspondent and dreamed of other possibilities. One idea was to start a sporting paper, either a daily or a weekly. And he lost a chance to become Winnipeg's Sun editor over a coin toss with Thomas Preston, then the Globe's city editor. Ross flipped a half-dollar coin, Preston called heads, Preston went west. Early in the fall of 1884, Ross was in Montreal visiting family. His father told him that Hugh Graham wanted to see him. The city's Morning Herald was in financial trouble, and the Star's publisher was considering a plan to set up a company to buy it. If Ross could raise some money to invest in the project, Graham would make him editor. It was, he told his father, an extraordinary opening for a young man. After his meeting with the publisher, he wrote in his journal that if he could get the money, I may, at the age of 27, have a powerful position, a fair salary, and unlimited prospects, for I can trust Graham. That deal didn't work out, but in the spring, Ross returned to the Star. He quickly moved from an editor position to parliamentary reporter to managing editor. But he didn't stay long. With bigger ambitions than just writing and editing, he wanted to own a newspaper. Ross had been in the Parliamentary Press Gallery in December of 1885, when Ottawa printer Alexander Smith Woodburn launched the Evening Journal. On January 1, 1887, while still in his 20s, he completed the purchase of half of the paper for $4,000, much of it borrowed against his mom's insurance policy. No one would have paid 4,000 cents for a half interest in the journal at that time had he known anything about the business side of a newspaper, Ross later wrote. The publication was losing money, was several thousand dollars in debt, and had no assets. Woodburn had set it up so the journal leased its plant from him and printed the paper on a press owned by his printing business. The circulation was only 1,700, and 600 of those were giveaways. Unfortunately, the partnership between a printer who knew nothing about journalism and a reporter who knew nothing about business was not the solution to the paper's problems. The journal continued to struggle so badly that Ross finally sought work elsewhere. In 1891, he accepted a job with a paper in Fort McLeod, Alberta, which he considered the very remote far northwest. But as he was about to pack his trunk, an unexpected investor suddenly appeared. Believing that everyone should perform some public service, Ross had joined the board of Ottawa's Central Fair. 2 years later, Charles McGee, the outgoing president of the board, asked him to assume the role. When Ross said he couldn't because he was leaving town, McGee asked why. Well, Between ourselves, the young newspaper man admitted. The journal is up Salt Creek. I'm out, and I've booked a job elsewhere. McGee was the president of the Bank of Ottawa, and had a reputation as a tough businessman who was not given to throwing money around. He liked the newspaper, but he must also have seen something he trusted in Ross. After helping him buy out Woodburn, who, despite all evidence to the contrary, insisted his half-interest was still worth $4,000. McGee and two others invested $30,000 to set the paper up properly. Within 2 or 3 years, the journal was profitable. In November of 1891, his job and financial situations sufficiently settled, he married Mary Littlejohn, whom he'd met during his Toronto years. In 1893, they moved from the Grand Union Hotel, where Ross had boarded since first arriving in town, to a house in fashionable Sandy Hill. On his birthday, New Year's Day, 1894, he recorded in his journal, age 36, never better or better off. Ottawa had been a good choice for Ross. It was no Montreal, of course. Montreal was Canada's largest and most sophisticated city. Ottawa in the mid-1880s was, by his own admission, an unattractive town of but 36,000 people, distinguished only by the new Parliament buildings. Yet, the old lumber village was now the fledgling nation's capital, and that may have given Ross confidence that it would be a good place to live, to own a newspaper, and soon to play a lot of hockey. In Montreal, Ross had been well known among the sporting, social, and political elites, and it didn't take him long to gain similar stature in Ottawa. He was an easy guy to like, smart, curious, and almost as much a fan of theater, opera, and other cultural pursuits as he was of sports. His height, lean face and athletic body made him a handsome man, and he was a good dresser. All that helped him forge connections with influential people. By February of 1888, he was accepting invitations to dinners at Rideau Hall. It didn't hurt that influential people liked knowing a man who owned a newspaper and wrote editorials for it. As publisher of the journal, he'd used his contacts to save the moribund paper. Influential connections would also come in handy as he helped revive hockey in Ottawa. When he started at the Journal, the rival Citizen welcomed him to the journalistic circles of the capital and added, "Mr. Ross will prove a valuable acquisition to the athletic and rowing clubs of this city, as he stands high among the athletes and oarsmen of the Dominion." Sure enough, despite his troubles at work, he was indeed heavily involved in sports. He was elected to the board of the Ottawa Amateur Athletic Association, and then, after being instrumental in the construction of a 3-story clubhouse with a spacious gymnasium, he became president of the Ottawa Amateur Athletic Club. While formally opening the building in November 1889, Sir John A. Macdonald admitted that he wasn't an athlete. Then, in his remarks, Ross teased the Prime Minister by saying he was welcome to practice on the horizontal bar or have a few rounds, Marquis of Queensberry rules, anytime he wanted. Ross was also president of the Bicycle Club and the Toboggan Club, and active in various other sporting organizations, including the rowing club. He rowed a lot in the summer and skated often in the winter. The Grand Union Hotel was at the corner of Elgin and Queen, a short walk to both the Rideau Canal and Day's Rink. He was known for his speed on his blades. One day, he accepted a challenge from a man who bet that no one could skate along the Ottawa River to the town of Buckingham and back in under 5 hours. Although the skies were clear when Ross skated away from Parliament Hill at 10 o'clock on a December morning, a snowstorm moved in during the afternoon. Still, he completed the round trip of 47 miles in just 3 hours and 55 minutes. Occasionally, he'd play shinny. In late November 1888, he wrote in his diary, "Rideau Canal frozen over. Had a gorgeous skate and a game of hockey in the evening." There wasn't much in the way of formal hockey at the time, given that the Ottawa Hockey Club had gone dormant. Despite twice competing in the Winter Carnival tournament and having been a founding member of the Amateur Hockey Association of Canada, the club had gone inactive in 1887, after one season in the new league, due to the departure of a couple of the leading players and problems finding suitable places to play. The Royal Skating Rink had become a roller skating venue, leaving the Day Brothers with the only indoor ice. Once they had a monopoly, they were not easy to do business with. Also, the city had no other hockey teams, making warm-up matches and developing new talent difficult. Travel was also a problem, given that the club competed in a Montreal-based league. But Ottawa was about to become a hockey town. The establishment of the Rideau Skating and Curling Club, located next to the University of Ottawa in early 1889, was the seminal event. 18 42-foot-high arches supported the curved roof of the elbow-shaped structure that featured a cupola over the entrance. Inside, the building had two ice pads, one for curling and one for skating, as well as dressing rooms, a check room, a bandstand, and a director's gallery. Lord Stanley, who'd only recently arrived in town, was the club's patron and one of the investors. He officiated at the formal opening, which included a fancy dress carnival, attended by many members of the town's high society. As its name suggests, the club had originally been built with skating and curling in mind, but it immediately resurrected hockey in the city. Ross went to the rink almost daily, either for pickup hockey games or skating. Meanwhile, the OHC reformed, with the young publisher on the management committee. Several members of the original incarnation of the team were back. One of them, George Young, brought along his 17-year-old brother, Weldy. The players reserved an hour of ice time on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays. By March, they were ready for a serious match and invited the Montreal Hockey Club to town. Ross reffed the game, and if there were any concerns about his impartiality, well, two of his brothers were on the visiting seven. Although Ottawa lost to the more experienced opponent, Weldy Young made a strong impression. At the time, teams left it to the forwards, including the Rover, to generate the offense. The defense pair consisted of a point and a cover point. Even more than the equivalent of what would come to be known as a stay-at-home defenseman, the point was originally almost a second goaltender. The cover point lined up in front of the point and was focused on defense as well. When they gained control of the puck, points or cover points looked to make a lateral pass to a forward or loft it high into the rafters to ease pressure from opponents. The puck might or might not make it down to the other end, depending on what was up there. In the meanwhile, the forwards would skate themselves dizzy trying to be in position for the puck descending from the gloom overhead, according to Charles L. Coleman, in The Trail of the Stanley Cup. In the rinks that were festooned with flags and bunting, the high lifts could be trapped and the puck might drop anywhere. But it was a crowd-pleasing move, and one the teenage cover point excelled at. Young got a chance and lifted a hot shot through the Montreal goal from quite a distance up the ice, reported the Journal. Terrific cheering greeted the Ottawa success. Not everyone cheered this new sport, though. Some skaters complained that hockey chewed up the ice surface and reduced their ice time. Just weeks after the Rideau Rink opened, the journal responded to the critics by running a letter signed by a humble votary of the game, defending hockey under the headline, "A Plea for One of Our Finest Sports" on the front page. The letter contended that the game did minimal and easily repaired harm to the ice and took little time from other skaters. It also argued that hockey strengthens the skating of all who play. It fosters a manly, plucky spirit. It trains the age and strengthens the wrists, makes strong arm and muscular legs, and generally increases physical vitality.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.